All right, we're going to continue to look at the grand enablement. We're going to try to conclude this tonight. We're going to look at the things that have been coming together that are all enabling the rise of the Antichrist. These things are all converging. And we've looked at about five of them. We were looking at the false prophet and about ready to talk about Babel last week, so we'll pick it up there in a moment. But our passage of scripture as we begin is in Revelation chapter 13. And in Revelation 13, we have two beasts. They come from different places, have different functions. These two beasts are empowered by a dragon. So that's the simple way to understand Revelation 13. And that gives you the unholy trinity of the book of Revelation and the time of tribulation. So we have in verse 1, the first beast. And I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads and ten horns, and upon his horns ten crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet was as the feet of a bear, and his mouth was as the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power and his seat and great authority. So we've got this first beast who comes up out of the sea. The second beast that we will see comes up out of the land. So this beast that comes up out of the sea is a political animal. He's got these horns and these heads and these crowns. These are, you know, maybe the revived Roman Empire, probably to some extent. But anyway, these are political entities all under one control. So this one beast has this, and he is empowered by the lawless one. And then down in verse 11, you have another beast. John saw another beast. This beast comes up out of the earth. And he had two horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon. So he had horns like a lamb. This begins to make us think of a religious entity. So we have a political or a commercial entity, beast, and now we have a religious-oriented beast. Both of them are empowered by the dragon. The dragon is behind both of them, and there's a whole study to be done in chapter 13, but we're not going to get bogged down in the details. So we were talking about last week, we talked about number 4 was transhumanism, and we pretty well finished that, but I wanted to add one verse to it. So transhumanism is where they want to take us, human 2.0. And they're going to continue to add things to us to make us something more. I believe that ultimately it's going to be genetic. There's a lot of people that are all over the conspiracy theory stuff about the virus, that if you take the virus, it's going to change your genes. That's not true. You actually can't do that. You might disrupt some things, but you can't change your genes. But I believe they are going to ultimately figure out how to somehow affect us genetically. We're not there yet, but we're being set up for there. Okay? Now, one of the reasons why I'm not all freaked out about these things, to me it's more interesting because I'm not going to go through this. You don't need to worry about the mark of the beast. For you, if you're a born-again believer in Jesus Christ, you're not going to be tempted to take the mark of the beast, because the mark of the beast is about worshiping the beast. Amen. If you're not going to worship somebody besides God, you don't need to be worrying about, you know, if you go to a football game and the seat that they assign you with your ticket is number 666, you don't need to worry about that. I've known people that they got a ticket from the cashier and it ended with 666 and they thought they were going to die. Okay, have a little sense. Have a little brains. If you study what the scripture says, these people that go through the tribulation are going to willingly take that tattoo because they love the beast. It says they're going to wander, they're going to wander after the beast. Well, that's not you and I, so you and I don't have to worry about that. Amen. Now, your grandkids might. Amen. And so these things are shaping up before us, but we're not there yet. But we can smell it, right? Amen. We can see it shaping up. And most of the people out there, they don't have a clue. They don't know what's going on. We have the truth. And Jesus said, what did he say? He shall know the truth. And I'm not bound by all these worries.
Amen.
Because I know the truth. I'm free. So there's a passage of scripture, though, in Daniel chapter 2, verse 43, that I didn't read last week that I think really fits into this transhumanism thing. And Daniel saw this this vision that God gave him of the vision that Nebuchadnezzar had. So Nebuchadnezzar had a dream. He told his wise guys, tell me what the dream is and the interpretation. They said, King, nobody ever asked anybody to do that. We can't do that. He said, well, you're going to die then. And Daniel said, oh, don't kill him just yet. Let me have a shot at it. Daniel went and prayed, and God gave him a revelation of the vision and the interpretation. And within that, nestled in verse 43, we have this. So the statue that he saw, head of gold, arms and chest of silver, belly and thigh of bronze, legs of iron, and feet that were partly clay, partly iron. Okay? And that plays off from that, that reveals a truth that God wants us to know. And whereas thou sawest the iron in those toes mixed with the miry clay, they, and to me that's a huge word to underline, okay? Not it, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men. But they shall not cleave one to another, even as iron is not mixed with clay. The predisposition of humanity right now seems to be to go against everything that God did, right? I think I saw today that the president was about to sign an executive order that was going to tell the military that they had to pay for, you and I are going to have to pay for, in the military, sex change operations. Everything that we seem to be doing is whatever we can do to be contrary to God's created universe.
Yep.
So transhumanism is that. It is against, you know, this is an amazing body. Now, somebody posted... Well, tell them we're busy right now. So somebody posted a comical... I guess it was supposed to be a joke about this doctor from back in the black and white days. And he said, you know, your human heart, you've only got so many beats in it. And you're going to, don't exercise because there's only so many beats. You're going to wear it out. You're going to die. Okay? But that highlights the truth about creation. Now, my car, that's true. There are so many revolutions of that engine before something stops. And it won't go on until somebody like Zach fixes whatever that is. But it's not going to go on. My body, on the other hand, I exercise my heart every morning because it's a muscle. It is constantly renewing itself. It is constantly replacing cells as they die. The human body is an astounding, amazing thing. I was diagnosed with diabetes, and so two or three times a day, I stick myself with a needle. By the way, the experts tell you, this is what my doctor told me, and if he sees this on YouTube, hi doc. The experts tell you, he told me, prick yourself once a day at various different times of the day. Okay, that's 180 degrees wrong. I prick myself after a meal at an hour and a half. And in an hour and a half, if my blood sugar is not right, I'm going to go do some exercise and bring it down. So that when I get to 2 hours, my blood sugar's down. I eat to my blood sugar. That's how you beat it. The experts are all wrong about it. The experts will tell you eat some carbs. Carbs are poison. Okay, I'm not even going to get off on that. But the experts, well, what was it? The experts built the Titanic. It was a volunteer who built the ark. You know, this human body is amazing. I can prick myself, and 2 minutes later, it sealed itself over and already begun to heal. My car can't do that. They haven't come up with a robot that can do that. That's the holy grail of engineering, to come up with a self-fixing device. They've never done it. But the human body, it does it every day, all day long.
Amen.
It's amazing. But this world is set against everything God has, the way He set it up, male and female. Now we've got, what, how many different things have we got?
Two,
that's right. We got two, just like we always did. So this transhumanism thing isn't just a brainchild that some human thought of. This is where the world system is headed. It's anti-God.
Amen.
The reason why the world is going to wander after the beast who is anti-Christ is because they're going to be anti-God. When we come to the time of the tribulation, it's going to be bad. We started off this study back in Revelation chapter 6. It's going to be bad.
Amen.
Almost hard to conceive how bad it is. And those people that go through it are going to deserve it. Paul said to the Thessalonians, because they loved not the truth. So they're not going to be any innocent people go through the tribulation. They loved not the truth. Everybody who wanted to get on the ark that Noah built could have done it. Everybody that wanted to leave with Israel by way of the blood of the Passover lamb could have left. And some of the Egyptians did. Did you know that? Some of them did. So everything that was left behind in Egypt deserved what they got.
Amen.
Everybody that was left behind after the flood started, they deserved what they got. Now that sounds a little harsh. It's the truth.
Yeah.
And you're not, we're talking about people who come to church and they talk about loving God, but there's something altogether different when they're at home, because they don't fear God. They're more concerned about you thinking that there's something good. And they'll go home and be something altogether different. And that's because, and they would never say this out loud, they don't love God.
Amen.
They don't fear God. And the truth is, I'd rather offend you than God.
Amen.
I'll get over you being offended a whole lot easier than I'll get over offending God. I'm going to have to do something about that.
Amen.
You see my point? These people that go through the tribulation, I know it sounds harsh, they're going to deserve it. Okay. That might be debatable. But anyway, this transhumanism thing is really a part of the times of the lawless one. So we talked about the false prophet, and we talked about what was coming up. Last week, the Pope met in Iraq, and they made much of that. And to the Muslims, self-esteem, embarrassment, that's everything to them. So for the Pope to meet with them and call them brothers, and he had an ecumenical thing that the Catholics do. And he had an ecumenical and included, we're all brothers. Okay. I don't know that he's the false prophet. I don't know that he's not. He's sure looking pretty good for it. So that's where we kind of ended up last week. And so tonight we pick back up a return to Babel. That Babylonian system is political, economic, religious. It is a unification of all those things, bringing all those things. And we talk about the one world government. That's a real thing. They're going to try to bring a one world government that has power over everybody. And we're being set up for that. And they're calling it the Great Reset. I want you to hear it from the mouth of the man. Okay? I think I'm set to do that right. Here's the guy, Klaus, who set up this economic forum that they meet every year, and we're into it. 2021 is the year that they want. Now, I don't think they're going to get it done. I think Americans and Yankees are far more rebellious than they have any idea. I don't think these things are going to come as quick as they think. But if they get us hungry and get us scared, they could bring things along pretty quickly.
We are coming out thanks also to the leadership of China in terms of fighting the pandemic, in terms of reinvigorating its economy. We have now a window of opportunity to create this global reset which we all need. This global reset is necessary because we have seen that our policies which we pursued before the coronavirus struck us, that those policies do not create the necessary inclusion of society necessary for harmonious societal development. And they do not create the sustainability of what we are doing. Just think of the global warming, how fast it is developing in the opposite into the negative direction. So we have a great opportunity at this moment, like we had after World War II, to have in some way a new beginning in our global cooperation, in globalization, in managing our global affairs. I hope that we will not miss this opportunity.
Xinhua News, Chinese news.
We're so grateful to the Chinese, aren't we?
Absolutely. Oh, sure.
And global warming has been so bad for us. We have an opportunity now. Now, so this is where this guy and Prince Charles and our president, this is where they want to take us. I don't think they're going to get done as easy as they want to. There's a lot of road barriers to it, but we're moving. We're going to be like shark's teeth, drawn in inch by inch. It's going to go in that direction. So there's a prophecy in Zechariah 5, verse 5. We've looked at it in years gone by. I want to see it again. I'll show you Zechariah 5, 5 about Babylon. Zechariah 5:5. Then the angel that talked with me went forth and said unto me, Lift up now thine eyes and see what is this that goeth forth. And I said, What is it? And he said, This is an ephah that goeth forth. Think of a bushel basket. He said, Moreover, this is their resemblance through all the earth. And behold, there was lifted up a talent of lead. And this is a woman that sitteth in the midst of the ephah. So there's the picture, a bushel basket with a woman sitting in it. That's bizarre. And he said, This is wickedness. And he cast it into the midst of the ephah, and he cast the weight of lead upon the mouth thereof. In other words, he sealed it. Then I lifted up mine eyes and looked, and behold, there came out two women. That's interesting. One went in, two came out. And the wind was with their wings. In other words, it's going to happen very quickly. For they had wings like the wings of a stork. Now, whatever else is true about a stork, it's an unclean animal. And they lifted up the ephah between the earth and the heaven. Then said I to the angel that talked with me, whither do these bear the ephah? And he said to me, to build it an house in the land of Shinar, and it shall be established and set there upon her own base. This is far and away the most bizarre prophecy in all the Bible. This is the strangest scene. I understand a little about it. I probably don't understand everything about it. So, I believe this is Islam, and the angel said it's wickedness. Let me question it, it's that. It's going to make its way to, very quickly, it's not going to be slowly, it's very quickly going to make its way to Babylon, or the land of Shinar. That was the place where Nebuchadnezzar set up a statue, and he said, everybody's going to bow down when the music strikes up. Remember? And there were three Hebrew boys, that would not bow down and worship. And so he said, cast them into the fire. And he looked in, what did he see? He saw four, and the fourth one was like the Son of God. And they came out, and there was not even the smell of hurt, the smell of the fire on them. So that's the area where all, that's the epitome, that's the the armpit of evil, if you will, or some other place. That's where those two women are going to be brought, sealed in this, and they're going to come out there. And so whatever else this means, Babylon is going to become the center, political, commerce, it's going to become the center. We think about Europe, and Europe is certainly going to be a power, but somehow it's all going to be tied back to the land of Shinar, Babylon. I would be surprised to see it begin to be rebuilt. So you see why we can't see how this could be in our times, but we see what the prophets see, and we're closer to understanding how that could become, right? So if you take the church out of the world, give the Antichrist full reign, things could change quickly.
Amen.
Right? So this could all really come to fruition during the tribulation time. It doesn't have to be during our time. Okay, any questions before we move on?
Okay, the question related to what women may represent in, like, I'll say allegories or whatever the case may be, where birds are usually evil things that go on. Would women be a sense of maybe governments that are unbiblical and that kind of thing, and that's why it's picturing the two women necessarily holding up the same?
In prophecy, or allegory as you mentioned, in the Bible, in prophecy, women used in prophecy are almost always women out of place or doing the wrong thing. The only exception to that I know of is the church. Every other prophetic use of women, these are religious authorities out of place doing the wrong thing. So these are religious, that's the reason why I believe it's Islam.
Was thinking it was some kind of representation.
Yep.
Obviously wrong.
Well, you're not wrong in that they represent something.
Right.
Yeah. But always in the Bible, you think about Matthew 13, the woman that hid the yeast in the bread. And over Revelation, you've got this woman that rides the beast. She's a religious authority out of place and doing the wrong thing. So that's what these women are. Yes.
So this globalism and all that goes with that is going to be centered in Shinar rather than Rome and other places that's thought of before in the past. Is that right?
That's going to become the epitome of it. Yes, the center of it. And that's what, when Babylon is destroyed later on, and the commerce leaders of the world weep over the commerce that's not going to happen. The center is the land of Shinar. I don't know how Rome is going to be a power, the revived Roman, but somehow it's going to, there's going to be a global worldwide system.
Could it be Rome be sucked into that area?
They're going to be connected somehow, yeah. You know, they could be a branch office.
Oh, yeah.
You know? Okay. So let's talk about the growing persecution of true believers. I've always heard it said that lukewarm Christians won't have any problem. They'll go along to get along. In fact, there are churches now that have not been meeting in person. They've been doing it digitally. They've been meeting virtually all this time still,
yeah.
But now they're going to begin to meet in person to become centers to give out the vaccine.
Oh.
Okay. So they wouldn't do it to please God. They wouldn't do it putting fear behind them and faking it, and worshiping together. But, because the president wants to get everybody vaccinated, we'll come together and do that. Churches that will go along to get along are not going to be persecuted. But they probably got our number because we didn't go along to get along.
Yeah, we just followed Jesus.
Yeah. But we could begin to talk, and you've probably got some stories, you know, Facebook, Google. A year ago, a little over a year ago, back in January of last year, I began to notice it undeniably. I could not use Google in the manner of searching that I did before. I used to use Google a lot, because it gave me access to my favorite commentaries, my favorite preachers, my favorite sources of information. But a little over a year ago, I remember in January, it was so pronounced that it was undeniable. Google was no longer giving me the search results. Something changed about the algorithm. For example, if I would want to do a search on abortion, some social issue like that, the first two or three pages that I would get did me no good at all because they were liberal, left-wing, and gave me no information that I wanted to have. Before that, I just got whatever the ranking, whatever most people were using, that's how they did the ranking. That's not true anymore. I've had people argue with me and tell me, it's all about the algorithm. That's where everybody's searching, so that's what you're getting. It's not anymore. Google has become almost useless to me. Now that's just one little tiny thing. Is Facebook doing anything against Christians?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, really? Did you say that?
I asked it.
I saw this on Facebook recently. Of course, you can see anything on Facebook. But I can't remember the guy's last name, but he was big, head of one of the committees, Jerry somebody, that was really trying to crucify Trump. He said just recently, or at least Facebook says that he said, we don't want the input of Bible believers telling us what the Bible says anymore. We can get along without that.
It would not surprise me at all. That would fit perfectly with, there was some senator today, I think it was on Newsmax that I saw it. He did an interview, and this senator said that there's a perceptible anti-Christian attitude in Congress now. So all over the place, we're beginning to see it. Now, we haven't really suffered persecution, and this is small stuff. There's Christians in the world that can tell you about persecution.
Amen.
They're being hung up by a chain and disemboweled in front of their families. that's persecution. Okay? So we don't need to be whining about it and wimpy about it. We can see it coming our way.
How long before they come after our Bibles?
Well, they're already disregarding the Bible, and it, like this guy said, if he said, Nadler is probably the guy that you're talking about. It would not just be neutral that you would quote the Bible. That would be a reason for him to vote against it. So maybe, we see it coming.
Maybe hate crimes.
And it's growing. Oh, yeah. I've already begun to figure out where we're going to go from YouTube, because YouTube is going to eventually... I can tell you about four favorite prophecy teachers that have seen this coming just like I have, and they have been censored by Facebook and YouTube. And you get three strikes on YouTube, and then you're off permanently. Okay? And so these guys have been struck, and they have already moved over, and I've already begun to look at our church is going to... In fact, I think I'm going to put our Wednesday night studies not up on YouTube anymore, but up on... my mind went blank.
Newsmax,
Rumble, Parler,
and Parler.
Now, I'll tell you who it is in just a moment. And of course, I'll tell you a lot before we get to there. Rumble. They're becoming the YouTube replacement. And I think that's where I'm going to... I may put it up both on YouTube until we can't. And then... So, we all have our stories tonight that we know of, that we see the persecution beginning to show its head. And, you know, we may go through... We've never been immune from persecution. We've been spoiled in America, but the church in the last 2,000 years, they've known persecution.
Amen.
Yes.
I do Facebook too much, but I said something that was politically incorrect, and they banned me from Facebook for a long time.
What do they call that? Facebook timeout?
Jail.
Facebook jail.
Yeah, so I couldn't get on it for a long time. I probably should have stayed on it. You know, I was reading, somebody was telling me that the ingredients in the coronavirus has male aborted tissue in
it. Let me.
If you research the ingredients, that's one of the ingredients.
Yeah.
I thought that was pretty bad.
Well, that's half true.
No, really?
Yeah. The original was made from aborted tissue. But every one of them is not made from aborted tissue. Originally, when they developed it, what they've developed from that... So every time you get a vaccination, or somebody gets a vaccination, it's not aborted babies.
Okay.
Tissue. But originally, when they developed it, they used aborted tissue in the development of it. So that's a half a step better. That's aborted baby is aborted baby. So that's terrible, right? But every vaccination does not come... How do you say that? Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
Yeah.
So the origin that they developed was from aborted baby tissue. But from there on, it's not. So I guess that's a half a step better. There's... So we're going to be hemmed in more and more. We talked about this last week. They have ways to make you get along. They have ways to make you... Now, I gave you the illustration last week. My doctor, dentist, got mad because I said I wasn't going to get the vaccine. What if he'd asked that question before I sit down in the chair? He said, well, if you haven't had the vaccine, I can't take you.
That's right.
And no dentist could take me. I'm telling you,
it's coming.
I'm probably going to get the vaccine. If the rapture don't happen, I'm going to go for it. Trust the Lord.
that's what you have to do.
Well, and that's just one little illustration of how they could do it. And that's on me. What if it's on my grandchild?
Yeah.
I'm taking the vaccine because it's not the mark of the beast. And dying's not the worst thing that could happen to you. But they have ways of hemming us in, and it's going to grow over time. Now, I think I mentioned this last week, I think this is the most insidious. You're going to be able to tell who's had the vaccine by whether you're wearing a mask or not. If you're wearing a mask, that means you didn't have the vaccine. If you get the vaccine, you don't have to wear a mask. And now we're going to be able to be embarrassed by being a mask wearer.
So just don't wear a mask.
Huh?
So just don't wear a mask.
Right.
That's illegal when that time comes.
Who's going to know?
Okay. Now we're getting deeper into the weeds still and important into our discussion. In China, they know.
But you don't have
a card. No. In China, they have facial recognition that even with a mask on, they know where you are and what you're doing. And you have a social ranking in China today based on whether you're compliant. I'm telling you, there's no getting away from this. You can be brave all you want to. You can bow your neck and be macho all you want to. You're going to comply. It just depends upon when they finally turn the pressure up on you to that point.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Now, I'm not telling you to comply early. Well, I'm not Doug, one of those.
That, Brother Doug, that gives those of us that are getting elderly, that gives us hope that we ain't going to be here when that time comes.
Huh? Well, I think the Great Reset is going to be the rapture.
Yeah.
I don't think the Great Reset's going to happen. I think Yankees are too independent-minded. But they get us hungry. They get us scared. You go back and talk to the people that lived through World War II, pre-World War II Germany.
Oh, yeah.
These are things that you don't want to be macho about. You need to think about where things are going. We may have already needed to have gone underground.
You need to seek God's guidance every day.
That's what the church has always done when they turn up the pressure of persecution, has gone underground. We're going to have to do the same thing. Either comply or go underground. Well, anyway. So, we're all in agreement. The persecution is coming. They're already beginning to turn it up. Okay. I was going to give you a couple of examples. People who call themselves Trump supporters. That's already being tied to the religious right. Right? And what has to happen to those people?
We have to be deprogrammed.
Or silenced. That's what Google is doing. That's what Facebook is in the process of doing. And QAnon. They want to connect QAnon with the religious right. Now, QAnon, how many of you don't know what QAnon is? Okay, well, let me explain it. QAnon was a conspiracy theory group who said that all of the people high up, Nancy Pelosi and Clinton and all of them, they were drinking stuff that was taken from young virgins. And they were then engaging in pedophilia to the extreme. And the government swamp was protecting them. Okay, now half of that may be true. I don't know which half, but half of that may be true. But QAnon became, so this guy, and it's been proven to be false. The guy was just playing with people. He would post things in the world in interesting ways, and he would just sign it Q. And he's the one that got everybody all hopped up that Trump was about to call for executive powers that would overturn the election and he would be president again. And this QAnon bunch were right there with it. Some of them went to the Capitol And they busted into the Capitol because that's what they believed. Okay? Now, these people are nuts. They're certainly wrong. I mean, Biden's president, okay? And I said this on Facebook a few weeks ago. Whatever sources you were listening to who told you Trump is about to be president again, whatever those sources, you should mark those sources and you should never listen to them again because they're completely stupid.
Amen.
I'm sorry, that was unkind. They're wrong and not trustworthy. That's the bottom line. If you've got any websites that you used to go to who they were into that QAnon, into that conspiracy stuff, you should never go to that site again because you can't believe anything they say. I can't underscore that enough because I get the sense that there's still a bunch of people that, well, yeah, they were wrong about that, but they still give pretty good information and they get me all excited. Stop it. Stop it. Just stop it, please. Figure out what is reliable information. And that's not that easy to do because we're living in a time where everybody's trying to confuse you. You don't know what the truth is. It's hard to get to the root of it. Yes.
Yeah. Have you ever heard of news before it's news?
Who?
News before it's news.
Yeah.
Yeah, my sister and my brother-in-law listen to that every day. I mean, they bombard me with, I know you don't believe it, but this is what's going to happen.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm getting that all, you know, not all day. But
so there are sources like that and One News America, I think, OAN. They're pretty good, but you have to watch them too. Okay, you need to check things out with multiple sources before you know a thing. Just because something seems like it might be true, and I'd really like to believe it's true, doesn't make it true. I'm telling you, it's not that easy to get to the bottom. Even those sources, and those are some pretty good alternative sources, you still have to watch them too. Newsmax. They've been wrong about some things too. You can't just swallow what Newsmax says. But they are one of the better news sites that I reference as well. Okay, 8 o'clock. Yes?
Do you think that there could be a big change whenever Harris takes over as president?
Okay, you're at least two steps farther out there than anybody can know. I know what all the conspiracy is about that. But that's not going to happen as easy as you think. Okay, Biden is, so dementia goes slowly. He's liable to survive a full 4 years as president with them propping him up. Earlobes aside. I just, things don't happen until they happen. Don't buy the conspiracy theories just because they might be true. Okay, it's 8 o'clock.